Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum salam.
A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Alif lam ra. تلك آيات الكتاب المبين إنا أنزلناه قرآنا عربيا لعلكم تعقلون نحن نقص عليك أحسن القصص بما أوحينا إليك هذا القرآن وإن كنت من قبله لمن الغافلين إذ قال يوسف لأبيه يا أبتي إني رأيت أحد عشر كوكبا والشمس والقمر رأيتهم لساجدين إذ قال يوسف لأبيه يا أبتي إني رأيت أحد عشر كوكبا والشمس والقمر إذ قال يوسف لأبيه يا أبتي إني رأيت أحد عشر كوكبا والشمس والقمر رأيتهم لساجدين قال يا بني لا تقصص رؤياك على إخواتك فيقيدوا لك كيدا إن الشيطان للإنسان عدو مبين وكذلك يجتبيك ربك ويعلمك من تأويل الأحاديث ويتم نعمته عليك وعلى آل يعقوب كما أتمها على أبويك من قبل إبراهيم وإسحاق إن ربك عليم حكيم صدق الله العظيم.
Sadaqallahu al-Azim. Allah has indeed spoken the truth. Shukran, jazakallah, khairan. On behalf of the IPCI, it gives me great pleasure to welcome one and all to a very happy occasion for us, a very fulfilling and rewarding afternoon on the completion of the introduction to journalism course. I think, Ismail, this was the third course for the year. This was the third module for this year. And alhamdulillah, it was the first time in this year that this project was undertaken. And I think it goes without saying the importance of the media in today's times, because in fact most of the battle that is being fought currently is a lot to do with the media. The media war is something that is very relevant right now, and I think I hope, and I'm sure many of you would have benefited from the experts we had who are teaching, because the people who are teaching this course are not just people who are in the dawah field at IPCI. These are people who are in the field of journalism. They're in the marketplace, and they are professional journalists themselves. So obviously they could impart to the learners the skills that are needed. I just want to say, interestingly, for many of you, some of you may know and some of you may not know, the importance of trying to sift the truth from the lies. The chaff from the wheat, the fact from fiction, is one of the greatest obstacles that are facing us today. We don't know what to believe today. It's not only reading is not believing, seeing is not believing also today. Sometimes they can show you something and it may not be the truth with all the camera tricks and gadgetry that they're doing today. Even seeing is not believing. But I want to allude you to a verse in the Quran, in Surah Al-Baqarah, right at the beginning. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is so fascinating. This journalism is mentioned as one of the top priorities in the Quran, and it is mentioned very early up in Surah Baqarah. That means in the opening verses, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَتَلْبِسُ الْحَقَّ بِالْبَاطِلِ, and why do you mix the lies and the truth? وَتَقْتُمُ الْحَقَّ, and why do you hide the truth when you know what is better? And here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is alluding us to the fact that there are this kind of people in the world who mix the lies and the truth and give it to us. And وَتَقْتُمُ الْحَقَّ, and at times they'll actually hide the truth. And sometimes journalism is not only mixing the lies, and sometimes not reporting something is also a disservice, a great disservice, because you do not want the truth to be told. And sometimes you distort the truth, but sometimes not even mentioning it is sometimes a great strategy, because people don't know. And I want to, from the dawah perspective, just leave you with one or two messages this afternoon, welcoming you, is that we all sitting here may be under the impression that Islam is on center stage and Islam is under attack and Muslims are under attack, and therefore everybody knows about Islam. But I want to surprise you with very recent surveys done, very in-depth surveys done in our country, in South Africa. If you have to do a survey for an average South African who is not a Muslim, you'll find out that if you have to put a score on 0 to 100% of what our fellow non-Muslim friends know about Islam, they'll score something like about 20%. With all that is happening, this is a reality. So what I'm saying is, I think we have to relook at ourselves and there's a great need for us to present our Islam. In fact, we're going to be accused for hiding the truth. That's my whole reason for saying this. Wataqtumul haq, by saying this, and this is a fact, we've been accused by some of our South African compatriots and fellow citizens that, why haven't you told us about this religion? We're reading it in the papers, but we didn't really know what it is. So I'm saying, wherever we are, in whichever discipline we may be, in whichever profession we may be, in business, as a housewife, wherever we may be, if somebody asks us about Islam, it is our duty to give them the message of Islam. They do not have to become Muslim. We're not talking here about, because that choice is in Allah's hands. Allah is the one who changes hearts. But to inform, just to inform them, and please come and approach us at the IPCI for books and booklets. We have many that are free, which gives a simple message of what is Islam. I met a teacher from Kwamashu the other day who doesn't know what is Quran. But he reads it, he sees the sign there, but he doesn't know what it is. You know, so I'm just trying to tell you how much is needed in not hiding the truth. Sometimes we may be guilty of the fact that we assume people know it. I want to conclude by saying, before I hand over the mic to Ismail Suder, who is the one of the senior lecturers in the journalism course and the course coordinator, who will be your MC for the afternoon, I want to just remind those present to pass the word around that inshallah this journalism course will be continuing next year. And also we have introduced a new format course in called Islam in the Contemporary World, a Comparative Approach. It's going to be a three-month module course. Islam in the Contemporary World, a Comparative Approach. It's for post-matriculants. It talks about meeting the challenges, the ideological challenge that we are facing as Muslims, comparing Islam with the various ideologies and isms that are going around, and to be able to engage people on an intellectual basis, on a rational basis, Islam versus communism, versus socialism, versus capitalism, versus nationalism, this whole issue of jihad, the whole issue of gender equality, which they are attacking us to say that we are not treating our women, we're ill-treating, all these issues which the media and the West is attacking us. We have a beautiful cause with qualified lecturers full-time, so you can have arguments and facts to give the correct position, inshallah. And then we also have the revert classes. Any new Muslim you know, you come across, who needs to learn basics of Islam, welcome to IPCI. We have courses free of charge, full-time teachers to teach you these courses. And obviously we also have adult English literacy. We also have a duty. We know that there is a high rate of illiteracy in our country, and I think one of the basic duties we can do as Muslims is to teach our fellow brothers and sisters who may not be Muslims even to just to read and write. Many of them do not even know how to write their name. They go to a bank, they do not know how to fill in a form because they were deprived because of the ravages of apartheid and deprived these opportunities. Now we have a fully vetted, certified EBIT course running at IPCI. And alhamdulillah, this year for the first time, there were 12 students who wrote the IEB exam. People who never held a pen in their life, today, this year, have sat and written an IEB exam in English, adult literacy. So again, if you may have a maid, a domestic, a neighbor, or anybody who does not know how to read or write English, is a basic course, again, welcome to the IPCI. And obviously, not forgetting the journalism course. With these few words, I hope you enjoy the afternoon. We're just introducing you to our summer. I think get used to it. The humidity is rising, but I think this is the test. And I think for those who are going for Hajj, this is just testing you, Ibrahim. So what you're going to experience that side. Once again, remember us and all of us in your du'as when you're there. And Jazakallah Khair, we have a very short program over to Ismail Suder, who will be your MC for the afternoon. Shukran, Jazakallah Khair.
Thank you, Rafiq. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. On behalf of the trustees of the IPCI, I wish to welcome you all to this graduation, journalism graduation. I also wish to extend a warm welcome to our esteemed guests. Our guest speaker today is well-known political analyst and a prolific writer, Sister Lubna Nadvi. Lubna is currently a political lecturer at the University of Durban-Westville. She had previously lectured at this journalism course as well, but due to work constraints, she has left us, and I hope that she will come back to us very soon, inshallah. But before I hand you over to Lubna, let me give you a brief overview of the course, the last course. The IPCI Journalism School was started in February of this year, and alhamdulillah, we have completed 3 modules so far. The course lasts for 3 months, and it is held every Saturday from 9 o'clock to 1 o'clock. We have produced, alhamdulillah, several good writers, and I'm pleased to say that several are writing brilliant articles for local Muslim newspapers like the Al-Qalam and Ummah, and I'm hoping that in time to come, these writers will expand to mainstream newspapers and television and radio, inshallah. There are various publications, Islamic publications, that are coming out. There is a new satellite TV station. There are radio stations. There's Channel Islam. There's various Islamic radio stations in this country. And I'm hoping that the students that we produce here, the graduates that we produce here, will move on to find job opportunities at these media institutions. Alhamdulillah, there are several who've been in this course who have been bitten by the journalism bug, the writing bug, and they have informed me that they will be pursuing careers in journalism next year, and I'm hoping that we would, in due course, have professional writers in our midst. At the moment, believe it or not, I can count on my fingers the number of Muslim journalists in Durban, in KwaZulu-Natal, and even in South Africa. No more than 10. And these are, when I talk about Muslim journalists, I'm talking about conscientious Muslim journalists, not just journalists, but conscientious Muslim journalists. How many are there? How many of these journalists, so-called Muslim journalists, do have Islam at the back of their minds when they are writing for their publications? I can tell you very few. So what we hope to produce here, the kind of students we hope to produce at our journalism course, are Muslims, journalists with an Islamic ethos. In the current class, we have trained, in the current class, we have trained just under 20 students, half the number of the previous course. The reason for this is simple, is in that many of the students were writing exams, school exams, and were writing university examinations, and were unable to participate. But alhamdulillah, the current course, the 20 of them, were very resilient, dedicated, and turned up every single week without fail. And that is very encouraging. My colleague, Sister Aisha Mal, who is a highly qualified tutor, conducted most of the lectures in media studies in the current course, and I came in at the tail end. Then there was Dr. Sultan, a highly qualified lecturer, and so was Faisal Khan. And both these gentlemen tutored in political studies. Several graduates today have the potential of becoming world-class writers, people who can shape the thinking of millions of people worldwide. A great friend of the IPCI, Dr. Faisal Suleiman, has dreams of providing bursaries to deserving students. This dream, alhamdulillah, may soon become a reality. We at the IPCI have another dream. That is to turn our school into a full-time institution which will offer a two-year diploma course in journalism. A few days ago, I had a chat to a trustee of the IPCI, Mr. Ibrahim Jadwood, who is currently in Saudi Arabia, and he indicated to me that the Saudi government, the Saudi authorities, were extremely supportive of a two-year course in journalism, a diploma course in journalism. He also indicated to me that if we have a course of that nature here in Durban, people from Saudi Arabia, from the Gulf states, and indeed from throughout the world, will descend on Durban to do a course in journalism with an Islamic ethos. That is the crux of a course that we are holding, a course in journalism which will have an Islamic ethos. And I certainly hope that, I certainly share in that dream as well. We have other plans as well. As you know, we have turned out some 60 to 70 students in the last three courses. My problem has been that we don't just want to churn out journalists who disappear into the crowd. It's like spitting in the wind. We want to nurture these journalists who come out of the course. We want to bring them in. We want to get them to write for our own student newspaper, inshallah, so that we will direct them. I can direct them, and my colleagues can direct them to produce world standard articles. So that is the dreams of the IPI School of Journalism, and I hope and pray, inshallah, that you will make dua that our dreams come to fruition.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum. For the fake romance of the self, human beings have dishonored the sacred right of poetry to turn the holy shrine of storytelling into a gallery. They take the mic for a lollipop to leak to the click of the camera. They pose a Colgate smile to dance to the click of the camera. They bury their heads in a forest of book to look for knowledge in a library and search for enlightenment in a dictionary. They travel from religion to religion in search of the ultimate reality. They migrate from cult to cult, questing for truth. They shall find no enlightenment in a dictionary. They shall meet no Buddha and no Muhammad in the library, nor shall they find Jesus in a church, mosque, and synagogue. They fail to learn the ways of Buddha and Muhammad in the book of real life. They bypass the wisdom of Jesus in the university of everyday experience. They cannot see the face of God in every man and woman in the street. The rod in the hand of Moses, the spear of Shaka, the harp and the sling of David, the diplomacy of Mushweshwe, the pen of Fanon, and the Mau Mau operations are means towards the ends, never to be confabulated with the ends in themselves. The mosque, the church, the synagogue, the graffiti on ghetto walls, the psalms of David, the trumpet of Masikel and Amazioni drums are mediums of expression, forms of worship, never to be confabulated with the object of worship. Religion is not life, but a way to life. Religion is not the ultimate reality, but a way to the reality. Culture is not life, but a way of living. The stage is not the objective, but a platform for the arts, a means of communication between man and himself, a place of communion between the material and the celestial. I hear the song of a child with a broken heart, and I scribble the lyrics in my heart. Gurus quarrel whether I am a street poet or an avant-garde musician. I see psychologists wrapped in their shadows, and I dance their slow motion walk. I hear philosophers talking to themselves, and I sing their mumbling. Mr. Scholastic goes psychoanalytically critical on the rap I shoot from the hip, till children hop to the rhythm of my heart beating the blues. A poet unknown in this city, a prophet in times of confusion, a philosopher in moments of uncertainty, a psychologist with the tools of words. I pick and package my words with precision, pack and unpack my lines proficiently. When reality is too stark, I poeticize. When poets are drunk by their own rhyme, I write poetry on the psychology of writing poetry. When psychologists are hypnotized by their own mantras, I prophesy the birth of a new psychology. When prophets prophets go crazy. I go philosophical on the psychology of prophesying. The fundi and the corner is there, throw semantics at each other over how to classify me. A punk poet, hip hop star, or failed musician trying his hand at poetry. A poet to hold underground. A prophet at the backyard of society. A philosopher with the tools of words. A psychologist pigeonholed at the remotest corner of the bundu. I pack and unpack my poetic analysis in psychological terms. I blow my therapeutic melodies via the prophetic trumpet. I offer the psychiatry of spoken words over the bongo drum. I am a therapist healing bruised mind with the spoken word that was there in the beginning to give birth to the sound that give birth to the universes. I am a poet, a prophet, a philosopher. Put all the P's together, even the P in the loo to define me, but never ever politician. I'm not good with rehearsed hugs. I cannot fake orgasms, nor do I change my caps more regular than I do my underwears, like the fat cats in parliament who shame prostitutes with the ability to lie their ways in the hearts and minds of everyone, but love nobody and nothing except their stomach. I cannot help being anti-poetry. Poetry has overstayed its time. No more time for pantomime, lyrically weaved rhyme, imitating sounds and cries of the time, an idealistic pipe dream to build a place for the displaced in the boundary space between the center and the margin. Beyond the lame excuses resonates the fervent cry for the ultimate flight from the tyranny of time and space, to uproot the center, to center the margin, to decenter the core, to mainstream the periphery. Poetry has become an opium bequeathing the people to flee from reality into nature, an intellectual to send people on society's touchline into an endless frenzy search for meaning in the silent text between the lines. Delude them with the lie they'll find a spiritual residence for their heads to lay in the mystical place between the textual lines. Poetry has become a passport away from social reality for middle class breaths with fat wallets to make it their leisure to write for pleasure. Ottawa does not matter to skate around the matter. Dreadlocks have become a trademark for mediocre name drop who attach a guavara and bantu bigwa with a twang over a glass of Smirnoff and a graphic description of New York in summer. Entering the poetry hall of fakes has become more than easy. An Erika Badu scarf, few lines scribbled over a glass of Amstel and the latest from Umzekezeke or Eminem to portray the image of a social rebel. Poets have become pimps selling lullabies for the parliamentarians to sleep in parliament, harvest better lives and a bitter life for all. On the walls of work in progress, unfinished, never to be finished RDP projects, graffiti the poetry on the wall, clear spell the truth in misspelled English to zulufy the anger of black kids who are pissed off up to here for being taught how to capital spell the J of G was and misspell the G in the gods of the ancestors. My poetry is not rave meant to transcendence into a state of fantasy. I thunder condemnation that phrase mongers peddling tired metaphors to promise a pie in the sky after belt tightening and knee padding to children who suckle thumbs for breakfast and lunch at the dumping ground at the height of the coca-lization and McDonaldization of the globe. Dreary wet wizardry drop bombshells on a world bombarded with metaphors weaved at the drop of a hit. Malpoetic, ill-political cowboys rhyme shoot from the hip, script tragic comedies out of human tragedies. The literati and numerati figure with letters and numbers to soap operize harsh reality into Oscar-winning movies. Telepathetic visions of mass information media imaginalize dead bodies into political scores counted like goals in a World Cup game. Summertime activists get into gear, unleash a microphone revolution to take their guilt-stricken conscience on an ego-tripping journey. Friedrich West smash of imperialism, fun running matches in Levi jeans and designer techies. Poet fingers lick the night away, ignite a burning fire, raise an anti-war storm. Cameras click, light flash, images on the screen, melodic voiceovers spark a cinematographic revolution to ignite a DSTV revolution. George in the bush smelt oil in the gulf, thought it thicker than blood, more sacred than life. He sat and saw things through the eye of a poetic illusionist, smarting out the creative genius of Hollywood. good to present the world via CNN, Suder International, the world to the cinema to imaginative eyes of his voodoo hood. Superman is dead, Rambo is history. It's time for the coalition of the willing, chasing the axis of evil, outsmarting world opinion with a metaphor for every occasion, to play the game so that the cards are open and control the statistic game in true Western movie style, where the slaughtered are victims of their own stupidity and the main star is invisible. In the theater of the absurd, the cry of the British people fall on deaf ears. As toy next, the minister become a messenger of the president who lost his head in the bush. The audience shake heads in disbelief as the former patron of labor parrot dance on a blood for oil theatric stage carpentered by the captains of capital for the coalition of the willing whores who sell their conscience for a bag of dollars and forget their morals on the table like they do their keys. Cut and out.
Very much indeed. Wow, that was information overload, but that's great. All right. I now want to call upon our esteemed guest, Sister Lubna Nadvi. Thanks.
Thank you, Ismail. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. San Bonani, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's great pleasure for me to address you this afternoon. Of course, coming after Ibrahim is always a tough act to follow, so I'll do my best to try and raise some crucial issues around what is currently happening in the world today. The theme of my address to you is around the notion of agency and justice, and I will elaborate as I proceed about what I mean by agency and justice. But let me just reflect for a few minutes on the events of the past week, weeks, months, this year, in fact. Ever since the war in Iraq happened, the world has not been the same. We have all reacted to it in different ways, some with anger, pain. Well, I would say most of the world has reacted to it with anger and pain. There have been those that have perpetrated the war, and so for them, they come to it from a different position. They rejoice in the suffering of those innocents, or they say that they are fighting this war against terror. They say that this is a legitimate, just war against terror. The reason I raise this point is about the issue of perspective. How do we see the world today? From one perspective, that is of the so-called coalition army that has perpetrated this war in Iraq, for them it's a legitimate, you know, action. For the rest of the world, it's unjust, it's illegitimate. And so the point about justice is, it seems as if justice is somehow subjective, but it should not be. Justice needs to be something that is universal, that everybody should identify with. And so when wrong happens, when something that is unjust takes place, we should all unanimously condemn it. The world needs to condemn injustice. And so, having redefined the world stage, this war in Iraq has now set forth a number of challenges for us. And I'd like to reflect on some of those challenges. I think the first challenge is about how do we actually react to power that is imposed on us from the likes of a superpower like the United States? How do we respond? How do we react strategically and constructively? Do we just go out onto the streets and chant and march and hold banners and placards? And you've seen many hundreds and thousands, in some cases millions of citizens around the world doing that. We all came out onto the streets to protest this injustice that has happened. What do we find over and above this, other ways to respond? The war in Iraq this year is just one example of the injustices that have happened throughout our lifetime, and certainly the lifetime of our forefathers and foremothers. And so the question of how do we respond is intrinsic to learning the lessons that we have learned from this war. I think that, quite frankly, we've seen that despite our protests, despite our marching and so on, the war didn't stop. What does that tell us? It still happened. It says something about power. It says something about the fact that, you know, there's a sense in which power that is absolute corrupts absolutely. We all know that. So my next notion in this address is about agency. And what do I mean by agency? Agency in scholarly circles usually refers to the whole idea of action, taking action or acting upon, or being responsible for taking action. And so this is really what I want to reflect on in more detail. And I want to talk about critical agency, which is where you as budding journalists and members of the public and citizens come in. What do I mean by critical agency? We all, you know, as I said, respond to things in different ways. The key question is, do we respond and just, you know, leave it at that? So we're angry and that's it. Or do we take it further? Do we become agents of change and constructive change at that? So we each have to ask ourselves this crucial question. I think we all would agree that the world is not a very nice place today. There's fear, there's intimidation, there's oppression, and all of these negative things. And so how do we change that? Can you change it? Can I change it? Can we collectively change things as they are? And I believe we can. Maybe these are the words of an idealist, and as Ibrahim reflected on some of those notions about how, and perhaps you were more cynical than I am, if I may say so, but I think that it's good to be cynical in that way. I think it's good because I think it reflects on where we are. I mean, it says something about the reality of the world. But then again, cynicism needs to be taken beyond just that. It needs to be acted upon. And this is where we all come in. It's about how we go about engaging with these kinds of things on a daily basis. We're not all politicians or activists or whatever. Most of us are just ordinary people who go to work, try and make a living, housewives, young people who are trying to get a job and so on. So we're all just, you know, trying to get along. But I think despite that, each of us has the potential to be incredibly powerful. We have the potential to, it doesn't matter how young you are or how old you are or how seemingly uninterested you are in things, we all have the potential to be able to change things. I think the great revolutionaries of the world spoke about Marx, Hegel, Fanon, Steve Biko, and so on. They spoke about the issue of change and justice and how change can come about with justice. And I think that is really the key issue facing us today. How do we go about bringing about change with justice? And what kind of justice do we want? In an op-ed piece that I wrote this week in the press, I raised the question about the capture of Saddam Hussein. And I said, well, he's now been captured. And so, you know, the Americans, the British, and so on will put him on trial. But what about the American president? What about the British prime minister and all of those other leaders who participated in the war, should they not be put on trial as well? Should they not be held accountable for their actions? Of course, Saddam Hussein has been seen in a particular way. He is being regarded as a dictator, and so he is going to face, you know, a global court or whatever system they decide to try him by. But my point is really about how do we judge culpability? If Saddam Hussein is guilty, surely George Bush is guilty. Surely Tony Blair is guilty. And so what do we do about those kinds of things? I think that we need to become citizens that are proactive, that engage with these things all of the time. And we can do that in very little and simple ways. When earlier on in the year, myself and other fellow activists were involved in the anti-war movement, which is an ongoing one. We talked about a range of things. We talked about, for example, consumer boycotts against the products of those countries that are waging war. We talked about taking on in different ways, whether it's writing in the press or whether it is participating in marches, demonstrations, and so on, taking on these various elements that perpetrate injustice and perpetrate oppression against peoples around the world. And that struggle has not ended. It continues, and it will have to continue. As Muslims today, we are under extreme pressure and extreme threat from a range of factors. Living in the United States today is possibly one of the most difficult things that, you know, the Muslim community is having to endure collectively because of the intense oppression that they have now begun to face. And in fact, living as Muslims in any sort of Western country has become extremely difficult because they are now being subjected to all kinds of unfair measures. They are being detained. Many terrorist laws that are being passed are now actually allowing governments to detain people without charging them or without, holding them without any particular reason. And so power that corrupts absolutely is being taken to a whole other level, and civil liberties are being violated. So how does this, you know, do we react to this? How do we change this? I don't necessarily have all of the answers, but I can certainly say something about the whole idea of us being proactive citizens. The one thing we really need to do, and again, this is perhaps something that budding journalists need to consider, is about using your voice, whether you use it to write, you know, or whether you use it to speak out vocally, but using your voice in different ways and harnessing that anger perhaps that you feel inside you into something constructive and productive, and using that. And imagine if the more than 6 billion people in the world came together and, you know, spoke out against injustice. Again, it's an idealistic notion, but imagine if that could happen. You know, the catchphrase of the world social movements is another world is possible. And Ibrahim, you can bear me on this. Another world is possible. And there they're talking about things like, you know, water for everybody, medicine for everybody, healthcare, education, those kinds of things, basic services. My plea is perhaps on a broader level. It's about justice for everybody. It's about making sure that everybody is able to claim justice that is not, you know, easily available, we have to fight. We have to fight to ensure that justice is done. And we can only fight just to ensure that justice is done through being active, participating citizens. The poets of the world, the teachers, the activists, and professionals of every walk of life do what they do. Some come to it from, you know, a position of selflessness. Some come to it from a position of having their own interests. But the point I'm trying to make is about moving beyond just doing something that is for the sake of doing it. It's about engendering a broader humanity. It is about engendering a broader sense of justice. Now, we are taught in Islam that justice is something that we will all ultimately receive. In other words, on the day of Qiyamah, where there's been injustice that has been done against us, we, you know, that Allah Ta'ala will rectify that. And so the scales of justice will be balanced out. But until that time, in this world that we are living in today, how do we, can we stand and watch this just happen? Can we allow this kind of thing to happen? Whether it is injustice happening in your own backyard, in your own home, in your schools, in your places of work, or wherever it is, can you just stand by and allow it to happen? Or can you perpetrate injustice? I mean, that is the other key question that we have to ask ourselves. So in reflecting on what is happening around the world today, the war in Iraq, the new state of affairs that, you know, we see happening globally, the increased oppression against Muslim communities, we can consider ourselves an ummah under threat, certainly. But as Muslims, I ask you the question, how do we respond? I say to you, respond with love. I say to you, respond with dignity. I say to you, respond with humility. And most importantly, respond with justice. Because that is really the key issue here. Many people have asked me, as a Muslim political scientist, why is it that, you know, your brethren, so to speak, are going out and, you know, blowing up buildings or launching terrorist attacks against, you know, innocent civilians and so on. So I say to them, well, you know, I can't answer for those deeds. And I certainly cannot, you know, justify any of it, because violence against innocent civilians is totally unjustifiable. But I can understand perhaps some of it. I can understand the anger, and I can understand the humiliation that must have perhaps been responsible for some of this. And then there is the kind of violence that, you know, just has no reason whatsoever. We need to take on a massive PR campaign, all of us, to protect Islam from being besmirched and sullied and, you know, portrayed as this backward, outdated religion and way of life. And we can only do that, again, if we respond with those ideas that I raised. Because, quite frankly, agency, the whole idea of acting, being agents of change, you can only really respond with love and humility and dignity and justice. Because at the end of the day, there's so little of it. There really is so little of it in the world. And perhaps, you know, you might say to yourself, well, such wonderful idealistic notions. Yes, they are idealistic in some ways, but it's not as if we can't make it happen. It's not as if we can't make sure that even in the little, you know, areas of our lives, that those kinds of things, you know, we can make sure that they definitely can take place. And so, in concluding, I'd just like to say that go away with the notion of justice and peace and love, because that is what Islam is all about. But again, that's what all humanity is all about. It's about ensuring that these very basic tenets of our religion, of humanity, are there, are entrenched, and that we can do something. We can certainly do something, even if it's very little, to make sure that justice does happen. I'd like to conclude by congratulating all of those of you who are graduating today. May you go out and become champions of justice and truth and of Islam. And so I wish you well in your endeavors and I congratulate you. Shukran, assalamu alaikum.
Now that was very thought-provoking, and you have all given us, you've given us something to reflect upon when we leave here. And now we've come to the main event, and that is handing out the certificates to the graduates. Several students have not turned up for one reason or the other, but I'm sure we'll pass that on to them. Okay, in no particular order, I'd like Fatima Jadwa to come forward to collect your certificate. Musa Biela. Khadija Jadwat.
Thank you.
Shake your hand.
How much is it worth?
A lot.
Money wise?
We'll talk about that. Moana Amina Abdallah. Sister, thank you. Isaac Mpanda. Congratulations. Aziza Mia. Zakira Sheikh. Khadija Osman. Felia Hawa Nampanda. Rabia Khan. And finally, Gemisile Kasim Kamba. And then there are those who did exceptionally well, and I want to salute them. First position is Fatima Jadwat. Oh. Please come forward. And in second position is Khadija Jadwat. She was pipped by a sister by just one mark. I'm not sure whether those in third positions, there's a tie between Nadia Sheikh and Ahmad Abdul. Is Nadia here? Okay. Nadia, congratulations. To all the students, I say thank you very much. I salute you. You have done exceptionally well. And I hope that you would go out into the world and make a difference. I certainly hope that you would keep in touch with the general media. You would write for mainstream media. You would write for the local Islamic media. There are so many Muslim newspapers and other newspapers in our environment that we need to take advantage of it and cull our writing skills. Like I said to you, in a not too distant future, we would come up with our own student newspaper where you would write for, which you would use it to showcase your work. And we will inform you, we have your contact details, we'll call you up, and we would like you to come and participate and write as much as you can and make that difference. All right. I want to call upon now, I want to call upon our first prize winner, and that is Fatima Jadwood, to come forward and say a few words.
Assalamu alaikum. Okay, I don't want to be standing up here because I hate public speaking, even though there's a very small public here. I just want to say that I was, you know, kind of forced to do this course, and when I came here, I didn't really want to be here at all. But then once the lectures started, it started getting interesting, and after that I didn't mind it so much, so I didn't half kill my father like I wanted to. The one thing I liked about this course was that there were, you know, integration of races, which I think is very important. I think that once we all go back home, we kind of stick to our own communities, and that's where the problems, you know, start. Okay. So if we mix together, we learn about each other, we can present a more united front when we are fighting against an injustice or something which, you know, something we don't agree with. Let me see. Also, do not be afraid to speak out when you feel something is, you know, being done wrong. Hail El Fahim. Don't be afraid to pick up your pen, to voice your opinion. It's very important that everyone speaks out. No matter how small you think you are, you can make a difference. And I just want to read something that by one of the greatest poets that I have ever, you know, read. That's my sister, okay? And it is not prejudice. No, really, she's a wordsmith. No, she's a wordsmith, and, you know, you must read some of this stuff. Okay, it goes, who will overcome this war? Who will defeat the economical hegemony that got us at its feet? The World Bank makes no room for those that are minorities, like women and workers, farmers and the informal sector. Free market is only free to those that can afford it. Because since 1974, the richest 1% has gotten 154% richer. The new world order ain't about races, places. It don't care about the color of your faces. World War III is purely monetaristic, building walls of economic segregation between the poor and the rich, widening the gaps, courtesy of market capitalism, capitalizing on technocracy, keeping the money lines tied from the BMWs to the TNCs. The aim is to maximize profits, gangbanging us with privatization and deregulation, effing with the poor of the underdeveloped nations. Production lines are moved to worlds with no unions. Uses and abuses of the people. A sexier word is neoliberalism. It's a turf word on a global scale. MNCs are the new military bases, effectively increasing both poverty and wealth. Which one goes to whom? I'll let you take a guess. The only way to fight it is to rage against the machines of the military and the media that's globalized the masses to believe. But they were deceived. The only weapons of mass destruction is the son of a bush and the corporate elite that benefited from the dumbing down of the world's majority. Democracy in the 21st century has less demo, more demons. Bush said in the Sun, that if he watched the polls, he wouldn't be here. Military bases in 120 countries have got empire written all over it. These new trading laws with goods being dumped, we've got to end this. The man thinks he's Jesus Christ, here to save us from the infidels. That dollar bill, in God we trust, has God endorsed Bush to F us all up. Okay, I can't swear here, so you're just going to have to mind that. Because if it's Jesus Christ we're fighting, we've got to become Pontius Pilates. We've got to end this now. Now, before it gets too late. That's all.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Fatima, and thank you very much, Khadija, for that wonderful poem. Your poem has had its first public hearing, so it's a start, isn't it? Inshallah, we'll get into a book one day. All right, I have item number 9 here. I don't know what's it about. It says student presentation by Khadija Osman.
Yes.
Okay. Oh.
This is on behalf of our class, the third class of journalism. For Ismail, Suder, this is thank you for doing an excellent
job. Oh, thank you very much. Much appreciated.
Okay, and for Dr. Sultan Khan, if you can come forward and collect your gift. Sorry, okay. Well, your gift is in front. Okay, and for Sadia. For taking over at such short notice. Thank you for doing an excellent job. That's from our entire class. Shukran.
Okay, this is Faisal and Aisha. I will certainly pass it on. Thank you so much from me, and I'm sure Dr. Sultan and the rest of the team. Finally, I want to say thank you very much for attending. I want to thank Sadia. I want to thank Mr. G.H. Suleiman. I want to thank the IPCI trustees and for all those behind-the-scenes people who made this occasion possible. And we want to thank the team as well for having the cause to have the cause run smoothly. And I want to say thank you, Jazilan. I want to thank my guest speaker who came at a short notice, Nadvi, and I'm pleased that she was able to make it at short notice as well. I have a little note here from Muhammad, and which there is a message from. It is from Mr. Jadwet.
No.
From you.
No,
oh, okay. Shall I read it out? Okay. Okay. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. This is from Hashim al-Attas in Jeddah. He says to Brother Muhammad Khan, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. With all respect and thanks to your great center, I, Hashim from Jeddah, appreciate the new approach of Islamic Dawah of media. I send here my salam to Mr. Ndaungwane and Mr. Ibrahim Jadwet. A few days ago, they were here in Jeddah, and I personally had the pleasure to meet these great men, alhamdulillah. It is my pleasure also to join the media and journalism course. Therefore, I hope to know when it will start and how much it costs and so forth. By the way, Mr. Ibrahim told me to contact you. Here it is. Our course is getting worldwide recognition, and I have no doubt in the months and years to come, we will have many, many people from all parts of the world, through most parts of Africa. In a last course, I would like to tell you is that we had students from up to 13 to 14 countries, from Ghana to Somalia, from Lesotho, from Swaziland, everywhere. And we will now, we it was an international course. So I have no doubt that in the years to come, we will have Arabs knocking on our door. So there you are. Jazakallah khair. Assalamu alaikum. And I want to invite you to join in the eats before you leave. And finally, before the eats, which is very important, we're going to call upon brother, what's his name? Ibrahim, to come forward and read a dua. Okay, Jazakallah.
Let's read Surah Fatiha. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Maliki yawmiddin iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in. Ihdina siratal mustaqim siratal ladina an'amta alayhim ghayril maghdubi alayhim waladdallin. Amin. La ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika la adan samadan lam yalid wa lam yulad wa lam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad. Jazallahu anna sayyidina Muhammadan sallallahu alayhi wa sallam bima huwa ahlu. Rabbana atina fi dunya hasana wa fil akhirati hasana wa qina adhabannar. Rabbana zalamna anfusana wa lam taghfir lana wa tarhamna lanakunanna min al-khasirin. Allahumma ighfir lana wa liwalidina wal jami'il muslimin wal muslimat wal mu'minin wal mu'minati fi yawmil hisab. La yaghfiru dhunuba illa anta. La ilaha illa anta subhanaka inni kuntu minaz zalimin. Amin.
Jazakallah, Ibrahim. Much appreciated. Thanks. Lots of food for the taking. I'm told there were samosas, my favorite, so please partake.